salutary, as they say. And so it's so good to be back with all of you. We had a good vacation down in Oklahoma, but are glad to be back with all of you this morning. This morning we're going to begin a sermon series in which we're going to be taking a look back at, the small catechism. We're going to be taking a look at what we went through. For many of you in your confirmation class, you might be wondering, why are we going to do that? Well, we'll talk about it more when we get to the sermon. So we look forward to diving into that this morning. Just a few words of announcements. Also, before we get started, we've got the sign-up sheet still for flower watering, as well as the honey festival back on the table. If you could sign up for those, that would be great and awesome. And then also next Sunday is our quarterly pulpit swap, where Pastor Caston's from up at Emmanuel Crystal City. He'll be down here, and I'll be up there at Emmanuel. Are there any other announcements this morning before we get started? Yes, Bonnie.
For the honey festival, we need some tables outside.
Yes, definitely. So if you have one of the easy carrying, not metal and wood tables, but one of those white plastic resin kind of bowling tables, that would certainly be appreciated. How many do you think we need, Bonnie? Three or four? Okay, bring them and we'll use them. Sounds good. And if people have questions about that, just reach out to you. Bonnie's fine. Reach out to you, Bonnie, if they can bring a table to reach out to you. Okay, sounds good. Any other announcements? All right, let's stand and greet each other with the peace of our Lord. God be with you.
Thank you.
find ourselves ill-prepared to defend our hope. When we do defend, we too often do so harshly and judgmentally. For this we go before our Lord in a time of confession. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. We take a moment of silence for reflection on God's word and for self-examination. may feast with him forever in his kingdom. Through the same Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Our Old Testament reading for this morning is from Hosea chapter 5 and 6, where we see the Lord desiring that his people show mercy. I will return again to my place until they acknowledge their guilt and seek my face, and in their distress earnestly seek me. Come, let us return to the Lord, for he has torn us that he may heal us. He has struck us down, and he will bind us up. After 2 days he will revive us. On the third day he will raise us up, that we may live before him. Let us know, let us press on to know the Lord. His going out is sure as the dawn. He will come to us as the showers, as the spring rains that water the earth. What shall I do with you, O Ephraim? What shall I do with you, O Judah? Your love is like a morning cloud, like the dew that goes early away. Therefore I have hewn them by the prophets. I have slain them by the words of my mouth. And my judgment goes forth as the light. For I desire steadfast love, and not sacrifice, the knowledge of God rather than burnt offerings. And this is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our epistle lesson for this morning is from Romans chapter 4, where we see an account of the faith of Abraham. For the promise to Abraham and his offspring that he would be heir of the world did not come through the law, but through the righteousness of faith. For if it is the adherents of the law who are to be the heirs, faith is null, and the promise is void. For the law brings wrath, but where there is no law, there is no transgression. That is why it depends on faith, in order that the promise may rest on grace and be guaranteed to all his offspring, not only to the adherent of the law, but also to the one who shares the faith of Abraham, who is the father of us all. As it is written, I have made you the father of many nations, in the presence of the God in whom he believed, who gives life to the dead and calls into existence the things that do not exist. In hope, he believed against hope, that he should become the father of many nations, as he had been told, so shall your offspring be. He did not weaken in faith when he considered his own body, which was as good as dead since he was about 100 years old, or when he considered the barrenness of Sarah's womb. No unbelief made him waver concerning the promise of God, but he grew strong in his faith as he gave glory to God, fully convinced that God was able to do what he had promised. That is why his faith was counted to him as righteousness. But the words, "it was counted to him," were not written for his sake alone, but for ours also. It will be counted to us who believe in him who raised from the dead Jesus our Lord, who was delivered up for our trespasses and raised for our justification. And this is example, somebody might be very passionate about golf. If you talk with somebody who is passionate about golf in this last week, you may have heard that the PGA Tour merged with the LIV Golf. That's a tour that's sponsored by Saudi Arabia. There was a lot of controversy about that. So you might have heard them talk about that. You might see that each year they have the latest clubs, catch up on the newest apparel, and if they are able, they may even buy a golf simulator. They get out to the course whenever they can, and they hit the driving range to improve. Some people might be very passionate about golf. People might also be passionate about cooking. No more same old dinner rotation. No, these people always want to try new things. They want to experiment with different ingredients and flavors to see what delicious recipe they can make. Still others are passionate about a particular team, like the Green Bay Packers, for instance, the best team in the National Football League. They may have an entire house dedicated to all kinds of Packer memorabilia, including autographs. They make sure that they watch every game and they catch up on the latest news about their team. Now, these are just a few, but people, of course, again, can be passionate about all kinds of different things. Well, where does that passion come from? Well, it usually has something to do with one's identity, one's sense of self. The person who has the golf simulator probably said or thought at some point, this is really important to me. This is part of who I am. Same for the cook or for the Green Bay Packer fan or anything else that people are incredibly passionate about. Yes, people get passionate, whether it's golf, cooking, a favorite team, or you name it, there's no shortage of things to be passionate about. But what about our Christian faith? What about our faith as we talk about it as the fact that we go to Holy Cross Lutheran Church, that we are Lutheran Christians? Where does the passion come from for that? I mean, after all, this is the most important news of all. This is the most important message that has been given to us that we believe by faith. But let's remind ourselves, of course, what is the Christian faith? Is it just doing enough good works to make God happy? Is it being a just relatively good person and not doing too many bad things so that we don't make God angry, also that we go to heaven? Is the Christian faith one that says, well, you know what, really, God's just a really nice guy, and all roads are going to lead to heaven? No, the Christian faith is none of those things, but rather the Christian faith is the faith that Jesus Christ is the world's only true Savior and Redeemer from sin, from death, the power of the devil. That's what he himself says in John 14, verse 6. I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Jesus' righteousness is given to us by grace through faith, as we heard in Romans. And in exchange, he takes on our guilt. He takes on our shame. Those things that we've had going on in our lives this past week, maybe even just yesterday, maybe things that have been a burden to us for years. Jesus takes all of that, takes our sin. Friends, this is something that we get to hear about each week. We hear that Jesus lived perfectly when we never could. Jesus took the punishment. He died sacrificially in our place for all of our sins. And he was raised to new life for our justification, our just as if we never sinned status before God, as we heard about in our Romans 4 reading. With the account of Abraham, Jesus himself promised and has now poured out his Holy Spirit on each and every one of you so that you might have the gift of faith and believe this good news. And we all know this, we all believe this, we all trust this, and we trust Jesus. But still, as we think about our passion for the Christian faith, and then we think about all the other things that we get passionate about, we so often see our passion for Jesus and his mission pale in comparison to the things we get passionate about on of these attitudes that the song of casting crowns comes through. They say this: but we want to see the heart set free. We want to see the tyrants kneel, the walls fall down, and our land be healed. But church, if we want to see change in the world out there, it's got to start right here. And it's got to start right now. Lord, I'm starting right here. Lord, I'm starting right now. Yes, dear friends, if we're talking about change in the world out there, whether it's in St. Genevieve, Missouri, or wherever we go, if we're talking about the passion of our Christian faith, the passion of Christ himself to seek and to save the lost, then it needs to start with each and every one of us on our own, personally, but I would say even more importantly, together as a group of believers, as a group here at Holy Cross Lutheran Church. But how do we cultivate that passion? How do we get that passion to stir up within us? How do we get that to go on in our lives? Well, this may sound a bit strange, but it goes back to your confirmation class, and it goes back to returning to your roots as a Lutheran Christian. And what that means is going back to the small catechism. Perhaps when you hear that book's name, Small Catechism, you think of boredom. You think of the pastor lecturing you. And you think anything else could be more exciting than reading and listening to that book. How can that possibly then give me passion for my life as a Christian? Well, that's what we're going to be talking about in the weeks ahead. Because having passion for our Christian life and on our own together with fellow believers comes from knowing who you are and from knowing whose you are. You see, the small catechism that Martin Luther wrote, it was never meant to just be learned once and then for us to just put it up on our shelf and then just have it collect dust for 60, 70 years, however long we're alive, or just put it up on the shelf until Jesus himself returns. No, Luther meant for that, this little handbook, to be a regular instruction and guideline for our Christian reflection and our application of the Christian life. How do we live out this faith that we have in Jesus Christ, both together in the church and then out in the world as we go forth to share that life with others? Well, Luther boiled it down to 16 parts, and this is a fun and exciting time in the sermon because it's pop quiz time. Last week, you got three sermons or thoughts, as Pastor Kirk called them, and this week, you get a pop quiz. And so, friends, I want to see if we can name all of the six chief parts together. What are the six chief parts of Luther's small catechism? And you can just spit them out as you remember them. Sam? What?
The office of the keys.
The office of the keys. Okay, that's one. Good. What else, folks? You're being put on the spot here. Sam!
The Apostles' Creed.
The Apostles' Creed. We got the keys, we got the creed. What else? we ask that you would give rain in this time of drought that we've been experiencing here and across our state and across anywhere where there is drought, that crops might grow and that all might be blessed on account of it. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Gathered in the forgiving love of Christ and assured that our Heavenly Father hears our petitions, we say with hopeful hearts and voices,
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is truly good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty Father, everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and saying, us to